Hey, everybody. Glad you could join us tonight for another episode of Empowering the Prophetic. We're grateful to have you guys with us. We've been seeing a lot going on lately in the church and around the world, and just, you know, all of the different things happening is pretty incredible what we keep seeing and what God keeps taking us through as a nation, as a people, and as the church. I'm here with Wendell McGowan. I'm Andrew Walker. This is Wendell McGowan. We're glad you guys could join us. Wendell, what's going on, brother?
Well, there's lots going on.
Yeah.
A lot of people are being challenged. A lot of people are being tested. But know this, with the testing of your faith, you're going to be purified. Amen. So I just feel like the Lord's really purifying his church. Mm-hmm. And you can't be discouraged if bad things happen to good people.
Yeah, right.
Bad things happen to good people. Why? Because God trusts them.
Yeah.
So that they can be hope for those who have no hope. So I feel like we're just in this great time, mm-hmm. challenging time. But it's a time that we need to be mindful of and be aware of. And truthfully, if we've ever need prophets, we need them right now.
Yeah, amen. Amen. That's
so
right.
That's what I'm seeing. I'm not just seeing a bunch of guys predicting a bunch of hocus pocus. I'm seeing guys declaring the directing of the Lord. And we're just experiencing here, man. I tell you, if you haven't been in a house, again, we are a kingdom-minded people. We're not trying just to build our house or a white picket fence. But I tell you, if you want to taste the presence, it's here.
Amen.
I'm telling you, yeah. We had such a rich presence, and it's like that every week. And some
Amen.
People think it's unusual, but that's the way it is every week.
Amen.
So I'm just declaring to you that I feel like God's going to start causing the presence of God to fall on you, your culture, your people, mm-hmm. and your spheres of influence. And I pray that our sharing, our talks, our blogs will encourage you to be able to get faith to know that God's going to do it with you too.
Amen, amen. You know, thinking about the prophetic, you know, because we talk about that a lot, building prophetic company and advancing prophetic company and understanding the prophetic learning, how to function prophetically and all that, you know, and you think about a prophetic company is not just prophets on their own and prophetic people on their own, but a prophetic company also works with the other areas and giftings of ministry, with the fivefold ministry. If you don't know what that is, it's apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, and teacher. And they work together.
Yep.
So, you know, thinking
yielding
about
that. Yielding to one another.
Yielding to one another. So
not one's the big shot. It's,
right.
It's a yielding to each other.
That's right.
And that takes practice.
It does take practice. And just like many parts of the body has many parts, and they all have a function. And they all work together, and they're all supposed to be working together. And I think that's the key, working together.
Yeah.
You know, you lose even one part of your body, and you notice the deficiency or the thing missing, even a toe. You'll know when that toe's gone when you start trying to walk.
Come on, keep my toes on, Lord.
Yeah.
Keep my toes. Keep my fingers.
You know when you're missing a finger when you go to grab a drink or whatever it is that you're missing.
So
everybody has to work together, and we're all one body. So when you think about prophetic company, not built on only those who are involved in the prophetic, but also the apostles. You know, the Bible says that the church's foundation is the apostle and the prophet. And the apostle has the grace of directing and building. How do the prophet and apostles work together in the foundation of the church?
Well, my experience is that apostles, not the big shot who comes in with a three-piece suit, usually beat up with their clothes shredded. Mm-hmm. And bites all over their body from people trying to kill them.
Mm-hmm.
But when you get the apostle and prophet together, then you've got a team that can protect each other. The apostle is the one who clarifies truth. Apostle declares truth, but the apostle clarifies the truth.
Mm-hmm.
And in that, they make and give understanding to the body or the kingdom to know how to build. So to me, you know, you can't, we've been through seasons where it's all been like just prophets.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody gets all, because the prophets will prophesy this and prophesy that. And then when they think they missed it, they're going to try to kill them.
Mm-hmm.
But if you got an apostle and prophet, then you've got more balance. And you can explain what God's saying. Because sometimes a prophet gets a word, and even though it's a right word, they don't understand how to unpack it.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas the apostle, God gifts them to be able to unpack
mm-hmm.
whatever the revelation is. So together they become a revelatory, I'm going to call it arrow, or a point, Mm-hmm. They break through mm-hmm. so that they can make a way where there's been no way.
So the apostle has the grace then really in helping establish vision and direction and clarifying, like you're saying, and often the prophets, they get revelation and vision, and the apostle comes in with them and helps establish that vision or build on that vision or clarify the vision and help direct, okay, this person over here, this one over here, whatever, let's get this thing going.
See, and when you get a prophet by himself, if he thinks he's the only one-man dog and pony show, he won't listen to an apostle. Mm-hmm. And when he gets, we've got a mature company of prophets raising up that realize, hey, I might have this revelation, but I don't understand the fullness of it. And the apostle comes in, oh, that's what that means. Mm-hmm. And then you can begin to put the building blocks in place for the kingdom to be established.
Yeah.
You know, I watched that with Bob Jones years ago. Bob Jones would give the weirdest prophecies. One time we asked him, hey, Bob, how do you get filled with the Spirit? And this is what Bob told us. There was a bunch of us young prophets standing around him. He said, well, boys, it's like this. Any of you ever drink a Pepsi? Well, he said, what you do is you shake her up real good, you pop the top, and what comes out is the fuzz on the inside and the fizz. He said, that's how the Holy Ghost works with the whole, with releasing tongues and the mm-hmm. Holy Spirit. What a definition. And then Keith Davis was who he had as an apostolic interpreter, began to unpack and say, well, this is really what it means. Mm-hmm. It means God's going to shake you so out of your belly comes rivers of living water. Amen. That's just one example.
Right, right.
But I just, you see in part and you hear in part. Well, when we work as a team, we see a bigger picture, and prayerfully we'll see the whole picture. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what God's up to right now.
Yeah. So that's apostles and prophets, but we also have, teachers. Teachers are a good one, and so teachers, are gifted in helping the prophetic, keep the prophetic impressions and words and revelations biblically sound, and helping to keep them biblically grounded or, just really grounded and sound in the word. And teachers will help with that.
Well, see, and you've heard me say this before when I've been teaching in our classes, teachers and apostles, their function looks almost exactly alike because they both move from a teaching function. The difference between a teacher and an apostle is an apostle loves to have prophets to come with them mm-hmm. and to get next to them mm-hmm. because it unpacks a whole new dimension mm-hmm. of revelation that they're not getting on their own. Whereas a teacher will, we always describe the teacher as a little finger. They kind of dig for the secret things, and they'll dig with their logical understanding for truth, whereas an apostle wants to get it from revelation,
right?
Even though it looks like it's the same. So teachers, I tell you, we're in a day where teachers are going to have the desire to get prophetic anointing cover them.
Absolutely.
Not that they're prophets, but they get a prophetic anointing. The same with evangelists. Evangelists of the past, an evangelist and a prophet look almost exactly alike in the way they function. They both work in miracles. They work in signs and wonders. They're gatherers. But the old model of an evangelist was, well, we just don't want to go and get anybody in the church because they're all a bunch of lazy no-counts. And they aren't getting out gathering people for the kingdom, which mm-hmm. is not right. Mm-hmm. Evangelists are supposed to be releasing signs and wonders to bring them into the church, mm-hmm. not to take them out.
Right.
So, I don't know if that's explaining that very well or not, but we got to get them all working together.
Yeah, so teachers can come together, and even the teaching gift and the apostolic gift coming together, both of them, the apostolic helps to build, or the teaching gift makes sure it's sound and helps to clarify as well, even as the apostolic gift helps to clarify. Pastors also release a grace to love and care for another, which has been a huge missing piece too. The pastor gift is the one that really helps people to feel loved and taken care of.
Okay, but see, here is the deal. If you read the scripture, pastor and teacher are the same gift. Mm-hmm. But the problem is most teachers are so concerned with truth, they forget about the love. Mm-hmm. But when you get a pastor who's really a pastor, in other words, Scripture only mentions that word one time in the New Testament. The rest of it's elders, bishops, overseers. But the truth is, a pastor is supposed to be a lover of the body. what he does. He's kind of a watchman. Pastor's more of a watchman than one that's out there just wiping everybody's nose. That's not a New Testament pastor. Mm-hmm. New Testament pastor is one who's making sure that the body is working together, coming together. When the apostolic and the prophetic are functioning, they become acutely aware. You know, you sense that as a young apostolic leader, Andrew. You work strongly in a pastoral gift, but that apostolic side of you is always bringing people to another place to where they've never been. But the pastor side makes sure they stay together so we can all get there at the same time. Does that make sense? Yeah,
absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah. And the pastoral gift is the one that is needed in prophetic company in order to make sure that exactly what you just said, that instead of just shooting for the next thing, that we're actually loving people into a place where they can not only understand what they're seeing and hearing, but that they can all move towards it without being left behind or stepped on or squashed.
Okay, now I'm just going to ask you, what's your observations of the pastors that you've been around in the past?
Well, you know, I really haven't really been around a lot of pastors because the pastors that were the pastors weren't pastors. They were usually apostles or prophets. And we've got this fly running around here. Sorry, guys. Maybe we should let him out the door. Anyway, the pastors that I encountered were not that. They had other gifts. But because the only gift that was allowed to function in the church was the pastoral gift, you had prophets who were pastoring and not doing a good job of it.
Because they're not called a pastor.
Because they weren't called a pastor. They were called to work with a team and have a pastor they were using. But then also, I've been with teachers who didn't have a pastoral gift either. And that's because they just couldn't figure that. It just wasn't what they were called to. They were teaching. But I've also seen apostolic guys that were more evangelistic that didn't want a pastor as well.
And apostles may not necessarily pastor.
Yeah, right. It doesn't mean that that's what it is. You know, the apostle and the prophet, often what those guys should be doing is leading the church and where they should be going. And pastors are there to make sure that everybody's being fed, not being left behind, being cared for, and those kinds of things. But because they've always said that you just have, so for instance, there's only been pastors in the church. Everybody's a pastor, right?
Mm-hmm.
There's no apostles, no prophets. Evangelists are just keep them at bay as much as you can, and then teachers are fine.
And prophets, keep your mouth shut.
Yeah, we don't even want prophets. Usually,
that's right.
We don't want that. And
that's
apostles,
from yesterday.
And the apostles all died out.
Yeah,
whatever.
Yeah,
that's been the current theme of the church for so many years. Where now you can have pastors. I will tell you this: that the lead pastors here at Dunamis, they are not me. That's not me. It's a couple here at Dunamis that are our lead pastors, and that's because pastoring is what they're great at.
And a lot of people don't even recognize it because they're busy just nurturing and loving the people.
Yeah, exactly.
And see, this is a new model. See, the pastors of yesterday were the only ones with the vision, the only ones that had any credibility, and nobody else, everybody else had to gather around them to help them fulfill their vision. That's not a kingdom foundation. They're good men, good people, right intention, but they've had wrong models from the past, and we're busting that thing up.
Yeah,
we are. God's called us not to kill these guys. We need to honor them. They're called of God, but they need to begin to open up to work with the team. I mean, we work with the team pretty well here.
Yeah, we have all of the every area: apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, teacher. We have functioning people in every single one of those here at Dunamis, and we work together as a team. So, you know, and what's great is, like, if I'm speaking on something or I've got something that the Lord's given me to preach on, and one of the teachers comes and says to me, hey, you missed this, 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 and this, I don't get mad at them or say, hey, you can't tell me that. I say, well, let me go look at that.
Yeah.
And then if I did miss something, I need to throw that back in there and make sure that that's being taken into account rather than, you know, saying, well, I'm up here and you're down here, so how can you even approach me? Well, that's just not how we do it here.
Yeah.
And we don't get mad at each other. We keep moving forward in what God's called us to do, and we work together.
Yeah, and see, we don't have a hierarchy. This is a deal that we've been after to break. What's a hierarchy? It's somebody who's not sure of who they are that tries to keep everybody beat down so that they make sure they're the king. But when you have a team that understands their call, their function and their sphere of influence. Then you have a functioning kingdom foundation. It's like everybody recognize, you know, I used to have a lot of arguments with a prophet. If I said his name, that most people would know. I laid hands on him many years ago, and a great prophet. I love him. But we used to have a lot of arguments about, well, man, when you're setting up a kingdom table, is it a square table or a round table? Well, see, I'd already had a revelation. It's a round table. Why is it a round table? Because it, what I'm trying to do is express prophetically that everyone has the same value. But there is always a leader that is recognized, and you don't have to have a rectangular table that sits at the head for everybody to come in and say, that's the king. It comes from a place of honor. And in that, it's like King Arthur's round table. And I've done a lot of teaching on that. I love that model, which was a true kingdom, that everyone that came around that table, nobody was trying to jockey for his place, but every one of them had value. So that'll be another subject we talk about on another day.
Yeah.
But, you know, this round table thing, we had that argument for years. Finally, he kind of changed his idea because he started to realize what I was saying. Mm-hmm. His deal was trying to establish a clear apostolic headship. Mm-hmm. Well, we're in a day now where people are recognizing, you know, we're in an apostolic hour, an apostolic prophetic hour. It's not just one. It's an apostolic prophetic hour. Mm-hmm. And we're recognizing each other. And where the scripture says, let the prophets be subject to the prophet. Well, when the apostles stand up, that's a prophet in charge.
Right.
And they honor that. Whereas when that prophet gets a word, then the apostle gives him honor, gives him the
blessing. You and I do that all the time.
We do it all the time.
All the time. No problem. It's easy to, it's actually easy to do.
And it's really easy.
It's fun. And the last one, so that's kind of the pastor part. And evangelists working together with apostles and prophets and prophetic company. Evangelists, you know, keep us focused on the prophetic expression that's coming down that deals with the lost rather than just the church. So the evangelist keeps that prophetic that's coming from the prophetic company. He keeps that prophetic vision moving towards the lost rather than just in the church. The pastors are working in the church. The teachers are working in the church. The evangelist keeps pressing forward toward the lost and allowing that prophetic vision to be expressed there.
But see, there's got, and right now there's a prophetic anointing, an apostolic anointing on the evangelist. Mm-hmm. That their whole intention is to, when they get them out there, they bring them in.
They bring them in, right.
And, you know, a good model of that is Mario Murillo. Mm-hmm. I'll use his name. He's public and he's putting tents everywhere and he's shaking California up. And I know him. You know, we've met each other and befriended each other. His wife and son used to go to my church years ago and his mother and father. But that beside the point, he's a true apostolic evangelist.
Amen. Yeah.
And he is charging the church to become the church, to become what we're talking about, mm-hmm. a five-fold ministry engaged and all of us working together to crush this antichrist spirit that's working on the earth right now. Mm-hmm. That's why God's after us building the foundation of the five-fold ministry, because that's the only thing that's going to break this absolutely ungodly, unrighteous day to pieces. And I feel like we're right on the edge of it.
Amen. 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 And that's kind of what we were talking about tonight. Just the fivefold, talking about the apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, teacher, how they work together with prophetic company, because you really need all the pieces. A prophetic company without that isn't going to go the places that it really can if it's not functioning in conjunction.
Oh, with my goodness. This. You know what? I'm thrilled. I mean, I'm dealing with some personal issues. But we win. Yeah. God is good.
Amen.
All the time.
Amen.
You know, no matter what you're going through physically, emotionally, spiritually, God is good all the time. You got to keep being reminded
Amen.
Of that.
Amen.
So, you know, I'm reminded of a scripture here in Jeremiah 6:16, and it says this, thus says the Lord, stand in the ways and see, and ask for the old paths. Why do we ask for old paths? Because they teach us how to build new paths.
Amen.
We don't need to go down the same old roads. We're building new paths where the good way is. In other words, this is talking about they made a lot of mistakes in the Old Testament, taking wrong ways and wrong journeys. Then you will find rest for your souls. But they said, we will not walk in it. also I set watchmen over you. This is what I'm gonna end right here. I set watchmen over you, saying, listen to the sound of the trumpet. But they said, we will not listen. Now, this is a scripture that's talking about how rebellious the church has been in the past. One thing we're dealing with is that rebellious spirit's been in the church, but he's setting the watchman out, the apostle, amen, prophet, evangelist, pastor, amen, and teacher, to sound the alarm in Zion.
Amen. Come on.
So that's my deal.
Amen. Listen, we love you guys. We're praying blessing over you. We know that you're being discharged by the Holy Spirit in this time, and that God has amazingly good and great things for you coming up in the near future here.
Yeah.
Wendell, you want to pray us out here?
Yeah, I just pray right now that the God of peace will crush Satan.
Amen.
Underneath your feet.
Amen.
For God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of love, power, and a sound mind.
Amen. Be blessed, guys, and we'll see you soon.